Good morning again. We'd like to welcome everyone who will be watching a little bit later to the University United Methodist Church and welcome each of you as well. Something I didn't say earlier is that I do want to take a moment to thank some people just right out. One, I want to thank Nancy for hosting the Methodist block party. I want to thank Norman for running and all the video equipment that is had, or at least half of it that's had during the week. And I want to thank Rachel for, I'm just going to say it bluntly, being a good sport and putting up with all the changes and everything that's happening every day, every week. Another person I do want to thank is Hunter. Now, you remember Hunter is not supposed to be here. Hunter's supposed to be in Florida at school. He had some problems and something with his apartment, so he came back for a few weeks. I'm going to tell you one more time, this is Hunter's last Sunday with us. But Hunter, you're still in our prayers, and our prayers go with you where you are. I want you to know that. Let's begin worship.
The Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rachel Hunter. That was beautiful. I went out to my garden this last week, and it's just about gone. The sun has done its thing. And already I'm getting catalogs for seeds to be planted this fall, namely wildflower seeds. But I do know that the signs of spring will come in December when I start getting all those catalogs about the vegetable seeds. And you get kind of excited when you talk about seeds and planting things, because that itself becomes a beginning. And I wanted to share some scriptures today pertaining to the seed. In Matthew, the 13th chapter, the 31st, 32nd verses, Jesus told them a parable. He said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his field. And though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of the garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds come and perch in its branches." Again, in the 17th chapter of Matthew, he speaks of the seed again, when he said to them, "Because of your little faith, I truly say to you, if you have the faith like the grain of a mustard seed, you'll say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you." The parable of the mustard seed. Probably one of the earliest parables that we have learned through time, because it's taught to us in so many different ways. As children, in children's time, and children's Sunday school, and vacation Bible school. How many of y'all, at some time in your childhood, did someone give a mustard seed and tell you about the parable? And yeah, me too. I really did. Matter of fact, I know that we teach about faith with that mustard seed, but I happen to know we get them when we're a little bit older as well. I know that in the 90s, there's a minister here by the name of Ray Henney who gave many of y'all a mustard seed, and some of y'all still carry that mustard seed with you. It was about faith in building this cathedral, in building this house of God, to be able to have faith as small as a mustard seed. You know, there are other parables about the seed. There's the parable about the one that went and was throwing the seed out upon the ground, and some fell on good ground and it grew, and some fell amongst the weeds and was choked out, and then the other fell on rocky ground and it just really never took root because there was no soil. We also are told about the man that went out and he sowed his whole field in wheat, and it started to come up when suddenly we find one of the servants came and says, "Sir, did you not throw good seed?" He says, "Yes." He says, "Well, weeds are coming up." And he says, "An enemy has done this." And he says, "Shall we cut it all out?" And he said, "No. Let it grow up together, then we'll pull it up separately." You see, the idea of planting has always been part of the idea of the church. It's part of what we are about. But I hope to give you a new insight when we talk about that mustard seed. You see, you may not know it, but the mustard seed of Israel is really small. You won't find it in your spice rack. The mustard seed of the mustard tree, it would take 10 to 15 of those seeds to make up one mustard seed that you have in your spice rack. The smallest seed that I can think of is actually a primrose seed. And when I go to plant primrose, a wildflower, I don't even know how to plant the thing because it is so small, I'm not certain it ever hits the ground, that the wind doesn't just blow it away between my height and the ground itself. But you see, Jesus is taking the smallest of things to talk to us about faith. But he's also talking to us about beginnings. That is his desire. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who planted a mustard seed. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed. You can look at this mountain and tell it to go jump into the sea, and it will obey. But to claim the faith as small as a mustard seed means that we have to accept the responsibility that comes with it. In the beginning, God created. And when God created, God put everything in order so it would grow. But he gave it to us. But think about that little seed. And he tells us, really, if you keep that seed and only have that much faith and really have it, you will have the faith to be able to move mountains. But what he's really wanting us to do is the beginning of planting that seed. That's why we give those seeds to the children when we teach them about faith. It's not so they can carry it around, but so they can put it into the ground. And unlike the time that they scattered the wheat seed, and unlike the time they scattered the other seed, the soil that is around the seed that we are planting is your everyday life. It's what you're going through right now. It may be the fear of what's going on in the family, the fear of what's going on with grandkids. It may be school starting back up and fear not only for the children, but for the teachers and for the therapists and for the administrators, for those that work within the school. Your fear may be the upcoming elections. But that is the soul that is around our life that suffocates us. And Jesus is looking and saying, if you will plant that seed. Think about that for a moment. To take and plant a seed in all the weary and dreariness of our everyday life with expectation. Now, I'll tell you, I've planted bluebonnet seeds in a lot of places. And the fact is, they rarely come up. And so I went and did a little research. And the research that I did, I found that I was planting it in soil that was too good. It doesn't like good soil. It likes that sandy, barren, a little bit of rock in there soil. Sort of like you see down in the hill country. It's not fertile ground. It's white rock. They build houses out of it. But yet you'll see the most beautiful bluebonnets during the spring. He's telling us to be able to take that seed and to plant it inside of our struggles as a symbol of our faith. But you see, if we don't plant it, if we hold on to it, it never has a chance to grow. Never has a chance to sprout. And once that seed is planted, it's got to be nurtured. You know, I kind of watch how things are planted. And the last time I was in Fredericksburg with Sarah and Caleb and the grandchildren, she took me out to show me her garden. Now, y'all seen pictures of her garden on Facebook if you follow her. Gorgeous garden. But when I went out there, I will tell you the tomato plant was barely alive. I want you to know the squash plants were withering where they were. I want you to know that the beans, they were barely even coming up. And I looked at her and said, how often are you watering these? And she says, well, when it rains, about once a week. And I said, no. You see, when we take that seed and we plant it in the ground, it also means then that we have to nurture it for it to grow and for it to mature. Proverbs, the 9th chapter, 10th verse says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. You see, the focus of this parable is more than just about the seed. It's about a faith that doesn't remain the same, but calls us to mature in wisdom. Calls us to be able to grasp what God's word is saying, as Proverbs tells us to do so. It means that we ourselves need to do more once we plant that seed. And there's a reason for that. Because I'll tell you, you can own a Bible. Lots of people own Bibles. And never open it, and you'll never mature from it. You can take a Bible, open it, read it, but if you never ask in prayer for God's guidance, you'll not mature from that either, because your understanding will remain on the level of the world around you rather than the level that God was trying to prepare for you. Remember, he prepared the ground for all his creation. To be able to do so, it means that the wisdom does come from study. It means that it comes from more than just grasping what the word and the world has to offer. I sit back and I look at this at times and I go, how do we do this? And it's because we choose. Every day we choose. One of the things that I've always been amazed of is that I have this person I'm very close to, not her, but a person I'm very close to that used to look at me all the time and say, Dad, just tell them you're not going to be there. And I'm going, but I have to be there. That's where I'm supposed to be. No, just tell them. And I'm like, no, it doesn't work that way. Just having that Bible doesn't do you any good. Just reading it without looking for what God would lead you to know won't do you any good as well. It means that we ourselves have to choose how we mature and how we nurture the seed of faith within us. We have to do more. During confirmation, I talk about prevenient grace, the grace before, the grace to choose. If I didn't have a robe on, or actually I can do it by doing this, I could say, I always go down to the third button. This is prevenient grace, that button. That is the grace God put inside of you to be able to choose. To be able to choose to follow him or not to follow him. It's called free will. That prevenient grace was the power God enabled in you to say, will you follow my path, will you mature in that path, or will you not? And as you've heard me say, that Luther said many times, every day when we get up and put on our pants, one leg is Satan and the other is Christ, and each time we choose who we will follow. It's the maturity of choice, that maturity of a beginning. And if we take time to nurture that, and if we take time to be able to look and say within Christ, not only your word, but more than your word, show me what you want. That's faith. That first Methodist Bonham, there was a plaque that was on the pulpit. And I first saw it, I really didn't know what to think. I kind of wish it had been a plaque with the Lord's Prayer on it, but it wasn't. It's a small brass plaque, and I hope it's still there, and it said, get out of the way and let God. What a word for the preacher. Every Sunday he said, God, get me out of the way, so that the people may hear you. It becomes my prayer. Lord, not my glory, your glory. Not my word, your word. Because you see, that's the planting of the seed. Because in the beginning was the word. That point that we can mature with. The word was with God and the word was God. According to 1 John. Or John the first chapter. And in that, when we sit back and look and say, we need to understand, we need to take time to be able to grow that garden. Why aren't my tomato plants still producing? Because I don't water them anymore. It got hot. Why is my okra sitting out there seeding? Because I didn't bother to pick it. Why, when you look at your life, is it falling apart? Did you take time to water it? To nurture it in the word of God, in the love of God, in the hope of God? Why is your life falling apart? Did you not pick the produce to be able to offer to others? You see, the thing about that little bitty seed is that when you look at the Israeli mustard tree, it grows 6 to 30 feet high. Think about that for a moment. Why Why did he use that? Why did he say it's the largest of the garden plants and becomes the trees that the birds can come and perch in its branches? He's talking about our faith growing to the point that our children can sit upon our limbs and they can find refuge. They can find a place to nest. So our grandchildren can sit upon those limbs. So those who age with wisdom and beauty can sit upon its limb. So the broken can sit upon its limb. But even more, by seeing the tree, they may come and harvest the seed that they too will plant it in their everyday life, and it will grow. You see, the church has thought too small over the years. We look at that little bitty mustard seed and say, if I have that much faith, I can tell the mountain to move, and it will. Think about what would happen if we planted that seed and it grew into a 30-foot tree. Then we fully understand what Christ meant when he says, ask anything in my name and you will receive it. It's about faith and growing that faith. It's about the beginning. Each of you, each of us, have that seed. Today, let's plant it in spite of our lives so that we can look to the world and say, no, there will be love. I will not cower from you. No, there will be peace. I will begin to understand the difference between justice and revenge, and I will lift it to God. I will look and no longer be in fear because I've planted that seed and I nourish it with the word of God that says, behold, I come quickly and my reward I bring with me. Is that not a faith to bear, a hope to have in this day and age? Let's plant those seeds. Let them grow so that the world is a refuge and our children have a future. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the many blessings and for your word. And we pray, dear God, that in this day you calm the hearts of your people and we see what is important and we let go of our hate, our fear, and we allow you, O Lord, to guide us. Guide us in the truth that makes the church strong. Guide us in the truth that wants us to wait with great expectation of your coming, but not wanting any to be left behind, but to take the time to plant the seed, so all people will know you are Lord. Amen.
Let's join together as we sing hymn number 191, Jesus Loves Me. Thank you.
Let's receive the benediction. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace for your journey. Amen.